the study of the relationship between the motion of bodies or objects and the forces acting on them is often called the study of force and motion. In a more specific sense, the relationship between velocity, acceleration, and distance is known as kinematics. Now, what is uniform motion? Uniform motion. Motion may be defined as a continuing change of position or place, or as the process in which a body undergoes displacement. When an object is at different points in space at different times, that object is said to be in motion, and if the distance the object's move remains the same for a given period of time, the motion may be described as uniform. Thus, an object in uniform motion always has a constant speed. Now, speed and velocity. In everyday usage, speed and velocity often mean the same thing. In physics, they have definite and distinct meaning. Speed refers to how fast an object is moving or how far the object will travel in a specific time. The speed of an object tells nothing about the direction an object is moving. For example, in the information in supplied that an airplane leaves New York City and travels 8 hours at a speed of 150 miles per hour, this information tells nothing about the direction in which the information tells nothing about the direction in which the airplane is moving. At the end of 8 hours, it might be in Kansas City, or if it traveled in a circular route, it could be in the back in New York City. Velocity is the quantity in physics which denotes both the speed and of an object and the direction in which the object moves. Velocity can be defined as the rate of motion in a particular direction. The average velocity of an object can be calculated using the formula v small a equal to small s divided by small t, where v a equal to the average velocity, small s equal to the rate of motion or average speed, small t equal to the elapsed time. Now, acceleration. Acceleration is defined by the physicist as the rate of change of velocity. If the velocity of an object is increased from 20 miles per hour to 30 miles per hour, the object has been accelerated. If the increase in velocity is 10 miles per hour in 5 seconds, the rate of change in velocity is 10 miles per hour in 5 seconds, or 2 miles per hour divided by second, expressed as an equation. That is, capital A equals to capital V F minus capital V I, that is initial, divided by T, where A is acceleration, V F the final velocity 30 miles per hour, V I the initial velocity 20 miles per hour, and small t equals the elapsed time. The example used can be expressed as follows. Capital A equals to 30 mile per hour minus 20 mile per hour divided by 5 seconds. That is, A equals to 2 mile per hour divided by second. If the object accelerated to 22 mile per hour in the first second, 22 mile per hour in the next second, and 26 mile per hour in the third second, the change in velocity each second is 2 mile per hour. The acceleration is said to be constant, and the motion is described as uniformly accelerated motion. If a body has a velocity of 3 miles per hour at the end of the first second of its motion, 5 miles per hour at the end of the next second, and 8 miles per hour at the end of the third second, its motion is described as acceleration, but it is variable accelerated motion. Newton's laws of motion. When a magician snatches a tablecloth from a table and leaves a full setting of dishes undescribed, he is not displaying a mystic art. He is demonstrating the principle of inertia. Inertia is responsible for the discomfort felt when an airplane is brought to a sudden halt in the parking area and the passengers are drawn for forward in the seats. In CIJ property of matter, this property of matter is described by Newton's first law of motion, which states that objects at rest tend to remain at rest, object in motion tend to remain in motion at the same speed and in the same direction. Bodies in motion have the property called momentum. A body that has great momentum has a strong tendency to remain in motion and is therefore hard to stop. For example, a train moving at even low velocity, it is difficult to stop because of its large mass. Newton's second law applies to this property. It states that when a force acts upon a body, the momentum of the body is changed. The rate of change of momentum is proportional to the applied force. The momentum of a body is defined as the product of its mass and velocity. Thus, momentum equal to mass into velocity, or capital M equal to small m into capital V. Now, if a force is applied, the momentum change at the rate equal to the force, or capital F equal to rate of change of momentum, that is equal to M capital M F minus capital M I divided by T. Substituting small m V for M, that is F equal to M F V F minus MI VI divided by T. Since the mass does not easily change, MF equal to MI equal to small m. Then capital F equals to small m into VF minus small m into VI divided by T equal to M in bracket VF minus VI divided by T. From the previous section, the second term is recognized as acceleration. Then the second law becomes capital F equal to small m into small m. On Earth, gravity exerts a force on each body, causing an acceleration of 32 feet per second square, which is usually designated as small g. The force is commonly called weight, that is capital W, using the formula above, W equals to mg and m equals to W upon g. Then on Earth, the second law becomes capital F equals to m into A, or equal to W upon g into A. The following example illustrates the use of this formula. Example: a train weighs 32,000 pounds and is traveling at 10 feet per second. What force is required to bring it to rest in 10 seconds? Capital F equals to W upon G into small a equal to W upon G into in bracket VF minus VI divided by T equal to 32,000 divided by 32 in bracket 0 minus 10 divided by 10. That becomes 32,000 into minus 10 divided by 32 into 10. 32,000 in bracket 0 minus 10 divided by 10, here 32,000 also divided by 32, which is equal to 32,000 into minus 10 divided by 32 into 10, which is equal to minus 1000 pounds. The negative sign means that the force must be applied against the train motion. Now, an example: an aircraft weighs 6,400 pounds. How much force is needed to give it acceleration of 6 feet per second? Now, capital F equal to W divided by G into small a, which is equal to 6,400 into G divided by 32. 6,400 into 6 divided by 32, which is equal to 1,200 pounds. Newton's third law of motion is often called the law of action or and reaction. It states that for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. This means that if a force is applied to an object, the object will apply a resistive force exactly equally to and in the opposite direction of the force applied. It is easy to see how this might apply to object at rest. For example, as a man stands on the floor, the floor exerts a force against his feet exactly equal to his weight. But this law is also applicable when a force is applied to an object in motion. When a force applied to an object is more than sufficient to produce and sustain uniform motion, inertia of the object will cause such a resistive force that the force opposing the motion of the object equals the force producing the motion. This resistance to change in velocity due to inertia is usually referred to as internal force. When several forces act upon an object to produce accelerated forces, act upon an object to produce accelerated motion, the sums of an external force are in the state of unbalance. However, the sums of the external and internal forces are always in the state of balance, whether motion is being either sustained or produced. Forces always occur in pairs. The term acting force means the force one body exerts on a second body, and non-reacting force means the force the second body exerts on the first. When an aircraft propeller pushes a stream of air backward with a force of 500 pounds, the air pushes the blades forward with a force of 500 pounds. This forward force causes the aircraft to move forward. In like manner, the discharge of exhaust gases from the tailpipe of a turbine engine is the action which causes the aircraft to move forward. The three laws of motion which have been discussed here are closely related in many cases. All three laws may be operating on a body at the same time. Circular motion is the motion of an object along a curved path that has a constant radius. For example, if one end of a string is tied to an object and the other end is held in the hand, the object can be swung in the circle. The object is constantly deflected from a straight or bracket linear path by the pull exerted on the string, as shown in the figure. As an object in the figure travels along the circumference from capital X to capital Y, the pull of force on the string deflects it from Y towards Z. This pull is called centripetal force, which deflects an object from a straight path and forces it to travel in a curved path. The string exerts a centripetal force on the object, and the object exerts an equal but opposite force on the string, obeying Newton's third law of motion. The force that is equal to centripetal force but acting in an opposite direction is called centrifugal force. In example, the figure given above, it is the force exerted by the object on the string. Without a centripetal force, there is no centrifugal force. Centripetal force is always directly proportional to the mass of the object in circular motion. Thus, if the mass of an object is in the figure is double, the pull on the string must be doubled to keep the object in its circular path, provided the speed of the object remains constant. Centripetal force is inversely proportional to the radius of the circle in which the object travels. If the string in figure given is shortened and the speed remains constant, the speed on the string must be increased since the radius is decreased. and the string must pull the object from its linear path more rapidly. Using the same reasoning, the pull on the string must be increased if the object in S swung more rapidly in its orbit. Centripetal force is thus directly proportional to the square of the velocity of the object. The formula for centripetal force is Cp equals to mv square divided by r, all r in capital, where capital M equals to the mass of the object, capital V equals to velocity, capital R equals to radius of the object's path. Rotary motion. The motion of a body turning about an axis is called rotary motion. This is the familiar motion that occurs as the crankshaft of the engine turns. The difference between rotary and circular motion is that in the case of rotary motion, the body or object spins, which in circular motion, the whole object moves along a curved path. When an object spins at a constant speed about a fixed axis, it has uniform rotary motion. When its direction or rate of spin changes, it has variable rotary motion. Now, momentum. Momentum is defined as the product of an object mass and its velocity. The force required to accelerate an object is proportional to an object mass and the acceleration given it. Acceleration has been defined as the rate of change of an object's velocity. This is expressed as a formula, capital A equals to capital V small f in that minus Vi divided by t, where capital A equals to acceleration, Vf equals to final velocity, Vi equals to initial velocity, t equals to elapsed time, Newton second law of motion, capital F equals to capital Ma involves acceleration. If the original expression for acceleration is substituted in Newton's second law, it becomes capital F equals to capital MVI VF minus MVI divided by T. This formula can be further resolved to illustrate for momentum by multiplying both sides by T. Ft equals to MVF minus MVI. This formula illustrates that an object's momentum is a product of its mass and its velocity. The lever. In its most basic form, we can think of a lever as a board or a bar having no weight of its own but supported by a fulcrum or a sharp line contact between two weights near its end. In the figure, the weight has a tendency to rotate a board. Weight A has a tendency to rotate the board in a counterclockwise direction, while weight capital V tends to rotate it clockwise. Each weight produces a moment or a turning force that is equal to the product of the weight times the distance between the center of gravity of the weight and the fulcrum. The lever is balanced when the clockwise moment exactly balances the counterclockwise moment. If we arbitrarily assign signs to these directions, we can say that the lever is balanced when the algebraic sums of the moments is zero. If a 10-pound weight is located 6 feet to the left of the fulcrum, it has a moment of negative 60 foot pounds. The moment of weight B and arm small b is a positive 60 foot pounds. And so the sum of the moment is zero and the lever is balanced. Now, A, first class lever. In the figure which I am going to show, we have a practical application of a first class lever. If we place the end of a 4-foot bar under a 100-pound weight, so the fulcrum is 1/2 foot from the center of gravity of the weight, we will have 3.5 feet between the weight and the point at which we apply the force. So we need to use a force of only 14.28 pounds to move the 100 pound weight. We cannot gain any work with the lever since work is the product of force and the distance. So in order to lift the weight 3 inches, we must move the force through a distance of 21 inches. We can prove this by finding the moments. In bracket, minus 3 into 100 equal to, in bracket, plus 21 into 14.28. That is minus 300 equal to plus 300. Now, B, second class lever. It is not always described capable to have the force acting in the different direction opposite that with the weight moves. For example, in a wheelbarrow, it is necessary to lift the weight of bird, but we want to use the mechanical advantage of the lever to reduce the force required to carry the load. In example given in the figure, we have a wheelbarrow in which the weight is concentrated 12 inches from the wheel axle and the force is applied 48 inches from the axle. It requires force of only 50 pounds to lift 200 pounds of weight, but the force must be moved through a distance of 12 inches to lift the support under the weight 3 inches off the ground. The mechanical advantage of a second class lever is exactly the same as that of a first class lever, with this distances small a and small f the same in each case. The second class lever is bolted back on itself and the direction of the force application is opposite that of first class lever. Third class lever. A third class lever is used to gain speed of movement at the cost of requiring a greater force to make the movement. As given in the figure, BC, a landing gear retracting mechanism. The force applied by the hydraulic cylinder is applied between the fulcrum and the weight in order to raise a 200 pound wheel. The cylinder will have to supply a force of 1600 pounds, which is easy for a hydraulic cylinder. The piston need move only 6 inches to raise the wheel 4 feet, and it requires the same time for a wheel to move up the 4 feet as it does for the piston to move the 6 inches. The inclined plane. Using the equation or figure given, we find that it requires a force of 166.7 pounds to roll the barrel to the top. Lifting the barrel directly would require 500 into 4 or 2000 foot pounds of work to be done. And since we are applying a force of 166.7 pounds for 12 feet, there is also 2000 foot pounds of work being done. Wedges and screw jacks are both examples of practical inclined plane application used in our everyday life. Now, third is the pulley. The pulley is one of the basic machines we gain mechanical advantage by passing ropes around the circumference of a grooved wheel. The mechanical advantage of a pulley is determined by the number of ropes supporting the load. To find the mechanical advantage, simply count the number of ropes supporting the load. Bracket. Load, do not count the rope which you pull. When you only one rope supports the load, the machine has a mechanical advantage of one, and in this instance the pulley is used simply to change the direction of the applied force. If instead of anchoring the pulley to the structure, we attach it to the weight, we now have two supporting ropes, and the machine has a mechanical advantage of two. We will have to pull the 10 feet of a rope to lift the weight 5 feet, but we can lift it with a force equal to only 1/2 of the weight. When we support the weight with a block and tackle arrangement consisting of pulleys and a number of supporting ropes, we find that we gain a mechanical advantage each time we add a supporting rope. If we have 4 supporting ropes, we have a mechanical advantage of 4. We will have to exert a force of only 1/4 of the weight, but we will have to pull the rope 4 times as far as we raise the weight. Now, fourth, gears. There is probably no application of the basic machine that is used so much in the modern mechanical age as the gear or the third wheel. We use it in clocks and watches, in our automobiles and airplanes, and in just about every type of mechanical device. Gears may be used to gain mechanical advantage or to change the direction of movement, and they do it smoothly and positively with no slippage. There are many forms and shapes of gears in use. Spur gears have their teeth cut straight across their circumference and are used to connect two parallel shafts. The ratio of the speed of the two shafts of the same as the ratio of the number of teeth of the two gears. For example, if the drive gear has 50 teeth and the driven gear 100 teeth, the driven shaft will rotate at 1/2 the speed of the drive shaft, or the gear ratio will be 2:1. If both gears have external teeth, the shaft will turn in opposite direction. But if it is necessary for the shafts to turn in the same direction, one of the gears can have internal teeth like those in the figure. Gear ratio is not affected by the direction of rotation of the shafts. Bevel gear, number 5. Bevel gears can be used to change direction and change speed, as shown in the figure. This is a tall rotor gear box used as a helicopter to drive the tail rotor. When an extreme amount of a mechanical advantage is needed, a worm gear may be used. This arrangement used a spiral ridge around a shaft for the drive gear, and one complete rotation of the drive shaft moves the driven gear on tooth. The drive and driven gear shafts of a worm gear are usually at right angles to each other. Planetary gear systems are used to reduce the propeller shaft speed of most of the more powerful aircraft engines, whilst allowing the engine to run at a high RPM for power. The propeller mounts on a spider-like cage that holds the planetary gears and allows them to rotate around the fixed central sun gears and ride inside the driven ring gear. It is also possible for planetary reaction gear system to drive the sun gear and hold the ring gear fixed in the nose section of the engine. The planetary gears are simple idlers in the system, and the numbers of their teeth does not enter into the gears ratio computations. The gear ratio of the planetary years must be, sorry, may be found by dividing the sum of the number of teeth on the fixed and drive gear by the number of each number of teeth on the drive gears. In the figure, we will see that if we have 100 teeth on the ring type drive gear and 50 teeth on the fixed sun gear, the propeller shaft which is attached to the planetary gear spider will turn 2 revolutions when the crankshaft turns 3.